Hey guys, welcome back to our season not included, Clay's Amazing Space Colony Simulator Adventure Extraordinaire. My name is Twitchi and we are playing in Twitchi's Tremendous Trojans. That is the name of the asteroid that I've decided to call home and set up base with all of my duplicants here. It was many cycles ago that we actually landed, near enough 300 cycles ago, that we landed with nothing but rock and printer under feet. The first few duplicants went around and expanded out and turned all the materials that we found into great big empty spaces and machines to go forth into the future with a nice easy life, as much nice and easy as we can. Right now I'm going around and I'm setting up water. At some point we're gonna end up with two different types of water coming into this this water tank of ours, and I don't want them like choking each other. There's only so much that you can get out of a water bed at any one time, so we're actually gonna set up those two systems with separate outputs. The other thing we're gonna do is right down the bottom here where the oil spill used to happen, I'm gonna start setting everything up so that we can have transport tubes running through that way as well. Look down bottom right, the slime biome down there. I'm not sure what we're gonna do with that, it's just a thing. And I am now going to spend a little bit of time looking around the map, because we actually need to do a thing. The thing that I want to do, I will get to in a moment, but the thing that I want to say about right now is, for some reason, ZTech, our master digger, has not actually had his priorities set up for digging. It's a little bit of a shame. It's definitely not the way that I wanted it to be, but we've actually gone around and corrected that now, so that should be fine. Brom's going around and finishing off finally some of these builds around the outside of the geyser, which means that we're starting to get through all the high level priority stuff there. Now, the thing that we're actually going to do today is the thing that I'm doing right now. You can see that we've got a morb in a pit. Yes, those morbs, they release polluted oxygen, so I would like to get as many of them into the slime farm as possible, because, you know, morbs release polluted oxygen, the puffs eat the polluted oxygen and then release slime, and the slime then goes into the mushrooms and everybody's happy, right? That's the way we're gonna work it, or that's the way that I want to work it. But of course there's a lot of things we need to do in the meantime. Most of these things boil down to either general base maintenance or going around looking for those little efficiency tweaks that you can put through. Some of the things that I need to do are like deliver the extra atmosphere suits to the atmosphere docks, make sure that the water is working fine. We've had a few problems with the on-off switch, but seems to be working out well. And now we're getting a little bit of problem in most of the cold biomes, where all the ice and polluted ice and stuff like that is around, where we're storing warm water in most of them, all those ices are starting to melt and we're getting quite a severe water buildup at the bottom. Now this actually is a curse and a blessing. A curse because it restricts our movement for the duplicants down there, that is no problem, but also a bit of a blessing because we can then just like collect all this water that is in a handy little pit. We can just like get someone down there, put a pump in, run it through our standard systems, and hopefully get some sort of excess water on the go. That would be beautiful. One other thing that I'm wondering about is, do I have any other geysers out there? Any other water geysers? I've only really found one, but I've got a feeling there are going to be many around. Okay, so one of the things that I also want to talk about is the germ content in the two water tanks. Obviously, in the hot water tank, ideally, all that goes in there is food poisoning, because that's how you deal with hot water. But also, the slime lung does tend to find its way in there. For some time, we actually have a little bit of an excess of slime, and when that excess of slime arrives, they put it into the slime algae distiller, the distiller that turns slime into algae. Pretty obvious. And unfortunately, that produces some wastewater that has slime lung in it. And for some reason that I'm not entirely certain of, that slime lung will overpower the food poisoning. That's the one I'm looking for. So I also want some way of dealing with that. The cold tank should do that, but that's a thing to bear in mind. Okay, talking about base maintenance, one of the things I'm gonna do is start a bunch of research, miniature valves for the win. I also wanna move on to some other stuff after that, but that's that stuff we need to do there. And other things I want to do. First, I'm gonna have a look through the feeding station and go, wait, that's not for puffs at all in any way, shape or form. Fair enough. I'm going to look through the list a couple of times just to make sure, but no, we're going to get rid of that. We also want a drop-off point in here, because obviously it's all good catching critters, but if we don't have a place to get rid of them, then we don't have a place to get rid of them, and then they'll just stay where they were, and that would be pretty terrible. Also noticing that actually the slime farm is not producing quite enough slime for the mushroom, so every now and then just having to dig a little bit more. Using the very nice clone command, I set up the
set up the Wheezewort to get delivered to the plant pots underneath the cold water tank as soon as they are dug. This is something that literally you can only do through digging. And another thing that I wanted to do was start upgrading the food that people consume, because of course we're making all this nice food, but it's no good if people are still eating the lice loaf and not getting the morale bonuses from that. So you can see there are Wheezewarts to be dug all around the place everywhere, and we're getting very close to actually being able to catch our first morph. Now, I've given the command to attack the Drekos, is that what they're called? Around the Morb, the things that give us the wool and stuff like that. I'm yet to find an actual use for them that I am, like, happy to use. Most of the time, the wool, I've not actually found the use for the wool, and there's are so many Drekos around that I'm like, well, what's the point of you? The problem with going around and attacking them is I don't actually have anybody set to have attacking as their priority, so this will be something that I realize and fix at some point, hopefully fairly soon into the future. And here you can see the reason why I'm thinking about that. We wanted to capture the Morb, but no, the Drekko went ahead and found his way in there. And now I'm like, oh, well, where do I put the Drekkos? Of course, I'm going to give him another little drop-off point just up by the hot water stuff, the hot oil stuff. Probably a solid place to put them. Not really much goes on there. And, you know, if I wanted, I could just kill them all over here or something like that. I don't know whether the natural gas would actually kill them. I find it a little bit weird that almost any creature can exist in almost any atmosphere. You would have thought that, like, as the duplicants need oxygen to survive, why not some of the others? Like, you got some of them that need the water to live in, but surely, like, the puffs, would die if they were, like, completely immersed in carbon dioxide. I don't know. That's another level of difficulty, maybe, that might happen. But with the clearing of the polluted water at the top of our base here, it's time to start clearing out all that room. I don't know what I'm going to be using all the room for. Slowly, all that's actually been happening is I've been migrating the farms and the kitchen northwards whilst not really moving anything else into its space. So it might actually finally start to be coming to the point where we want some extra duplicants in this. I've left the edible inventory list open on the right hand side, and you can see that we have more than enough food to go around for extra duplicants. So yeah, maybe it's time to make ourselves another the word that I'm looking for is a barracks, another barracks at some point. Bring in some duplicates, see how much food we need. We would obviously need to increase the number of toilets and maybe make the waste system a little bit better. Having another sieve to process the food, the water down, would be pretty good. Okay, so here comes Travicus to come and beat up the Drek. I was kind of hoping that the trap would be kept, but no, the trap is instantly destroyed. Bit of a shame, but that's the way it's going down. Travicus was the man that we made into the combat dude. I have a feeling he's the guy with the most combat experience. I hear he at least spent some time in the army as opposed to everyone else who probably has not even been in a fist fight. I was gonna say that that's like all only based on my life experience, but actually even I, the massive pacifist, have found myself in fights that I did not start. So yeah, maybe that may have been unfair, guys, sorry. So I was saying I was having a few problems with the on-off switch over here with the water system, and the problem actually is one of minimum inputs, like a data selection issue, if you will. The hydro sensor can only really go the hydro sensor can detect all the way down to zero kilograms of water. Unfortunately, when you grab the slider and drag it all the way down to the bottom, it minimizes down at 3 kilograms. And if you have a valve outlet down underneath the surface of the water, it will only push about 100 grams up into the space above it, so that it doesn't actually trigger that 3 kilogram minimum that it's got set. If you just go in and put literally a zero, highlight the number, put the zero in instead, it will work fine for you. Okay, another problem that we've got is we are starting to have a bit of heat leak through the airlock. I mean, that's kind of to be expected if you stop and think about it. It's where people come in and out. Fair enough, we've got a positive pressure pushing air out, but there's still a lot of movement going through there, so it's something to be expected. Thankfully, we've been opening up a whole bunch of these ice biomes, and that means we've got more Wheezewarts. Not that we know what to do with, we know exactly what to do with them. In fact, we're probably, if anything, running a slightly at a Wheezewart minus, deficit? Deficit, yeah, that's the word I'm looking for. So it would be nice just to be able to keep that going. All right, we're gonna put a new sort of an airlock here. As you can see, there's a lot of polluted oxygen spilling out of the slime biome there. And also, there's some nice stuff to go exploring over that way. But whilst we're onto that, Shroudica's going to do the nasty and beat up a whole bunch of bad guys, and Brum's coming along and making the ladders. So hopefully, at some point very soon, we can actually put down that critter trap there and get one of those lava morbs. Desperately trying to get a morb. At the same time, over in the slime biome, going for one of those pre-civilization rooms. I don't know what those rooms are supposed to be called. We've had this discussion many times. I don't know. Pre-civilization seems like a good one. One thing that I am noticing is that Shadow, when they go down into the critter room, only ever seems to be grooming the puffs. I'm not sure if morbs are just like not domesticatable. That may or may not be the case. I'm not entirely certain. I would like to know. If anybody out there actually knows, that would be pretty good. Maybe, just maybe, I've overcrowded them and there's no way of doing all those things. So my plan over the next couple of episodes is to slowly start emptying out most of the slime biomes. They're generally quite nice biomes. They like to sit at around 25, 30 degrees centigrade, but they're full of slime lung, and that's the bad thing. But we can process slime into much nicer stuff, so we're going to be watching all of that. Also, talking of watching all those skills that just got put into place there, we've mainly got a situation where we have met the skill needs of the colony. There's going to be a few things we need to do moving forwards. Like, we could definitely do with another doctor on hand, and I believe other than Ruby, we set someone else for it. Maybe Sir Steve, I can't remember. There was someone else who really wanted to be a caregiver, so we set them up for that as well. But of course, as said, if we're going to start bringing other people in, we need to start thinking about expanding just all of the systems. Not only would we need like extra food, extra sleeping space, extra hygiene, water facilities, the current cooling system is it's a little bit primitive, shall we say. We pick up a plant, we put it down in an area, and we hope that the plant can deal with the amount of warm that's coming through. This is probably not the best one. What we need to do is like get some sort of system that sucks up the hot gases from places, sends it through some sort of cooling system, and then pumps out cold gas on the other side. I think that's quite a good idea. If we could get some way of the cooling system feeding the heat that it produces into the heating system of the hot water tanks, that would be a wonderful. Shroudica's just kind of finishing off the last Drex that we got to worry about there, and then with that being the last Drex, I'm going to send Shroudica's to the infirmary. He has taken a few wounds, and you know, we look after our soldiers here. We've got to make sure that everybody is in tip-top fighting condition, because fair enough, we're just fighting woodland creatures and farmyard animals right now. At some point, we might actually have to face some alien invaders from the Great Big Black from beyond. I don't know. It might be, it might not. We're going to make sure. Anyway, let's look at this bug right here where Sir Steve left his health bar behind. Well, that's actually his oxygen bar, right? It's all to do with the follow cam. We're watching him because he is currently carrying a morb. And the follow cam is just like the buggiest part of the game. His model mucks around and, so whilst he was carrying the morb, nighttime happened and now he's going to go look for food. Look for food right where we wanted him to drop the morb off, wouldn't you know? But yeah, he left that behind. So we've got to build a new morb trap. That was crazy. But yeah, the follow cam seems to be really bad. If you play the game and you follow a duplicant around, it's got all sorts of weird interpolation errors and stuff like that, where you see two models of your duplicant. Things like the, you know, at the edge of the map, the things don't line up right, where obviously it's camera orientated and not duplicant orientated and stuff like that. Yeah, it's pretty naff actually, if you ask me, for a game that is this close to being released. I just assume that they've decided that it's not as important as game features, which, like, to be honest, it's not as important as game features. So everything seems to be going really well in the area over here, but I've got a bit of an insidious plan taking part in my brain. You see, we need more morbs, and I just don't seem to be able to find any morbs hanging around. Though we do have this one resource that just keeps turning up, and I think we can utilize this resource a little bit better. We're going to go into some slightly darker realms here. Yeah, so we put a toilet down. This, unfortunately, has made the room not a stable, so I've got to put some airflow tiles up just to fix that. But we're going to make sure that there is a comfortable, big inverted commas, living space in there, because it's time to send a duplicant in. Now, I have recently found out that if you just leave an outhouse in a room that is fully full and has not been cleaned, etc., etc., that will produce a morb. I didn't know this at the time, so we're going to do something a little bit more old school, something a little bit more dark, or something a little bit more scary, but we'll talk about that at the time. One of the other things I think that we're going to do right now is to make a little corridor up above. It's just going to be nice to open up the map and make sure that we can see everything, see the full boundary to space. And talking about the full boundary to space, Mad Frank has finally gone and got his astronaut wings, or at least his space cadet wings, so that we can start giving him some training. We also want to get him ready to fly a rocket. This is what we're all heading towards. This is what some of my research has been heading towards today. We are slowly going to make our way there. Landstrider, as well as being a beautiful artist, is actually going to become a caregiver as well. Trivaldo, welcome Trivaldo to the group. Now, he's just a temporary resident, don't worry too much about him, but we're gonna give him all sorts of special permissions. Now, he can actually go through a lot of the airlocks that other duplicants can't, but more importantly, he can't go through the main airlock that other duplicants can. So he's gone and walked his way into this room. Now, I've given the door that he's got there one-way permissions and one-way permissions only. I'm gonna let Tommy in and out so he can clean up the area. Because, you know, it's very important that the people that are gonna lay down their sacrifices for us are honored in their final days. Bad vaculizer though, so we're gonna send Mad Frank through there. But it's time to turn Mad Frank into some sort of like super being. I know that like, a superhero is actually a category in this game, but we're gonna go through and we are gonna fill him with every neural vaculizer that we find. Gets a sunny disposition, bonuses to morale all the time. So, Trivaldo, 3,000 calories. Let's keep an eye on that as we go down. Unfortunately, the skills box keeps on telling me that someone needs to spend their skill point, and that person is Trivaldo. And I'm not certain that I want to invest that much time and effort picking a skill for him. So we're gonna leave that one blank for now. There's a few little jobs around the colony that I really want to get fixed. There's a few walls that need to be put into place, a few ladders that need to go down, access ways that need to be dug. But also, let's have a look around and see what we've got down here. It's mostly hot stuff. We've got an oil well, but I'm not actually doing that much with oil right now, which I was thinking at the time is a bit of a shame. Maybe I could start like putting plastic tiles everywhere or something like that, just something to really start boosting the demand of those particular products. That would be pretty nice. Okay, so this sort of major access way up and down, I want to kind of make a nice little sealed unit so that we don't aren't exposing our duplicants to the wild world out there. Watching the germs go down in our hot water tank. Yes, it is the hot water tank. We're down to 1,000 germs, which means that very, very shortly we are going to be able to pump that out. As soon as it gets down below somewhere around 500 germs, something like that, they actually start dying from underpopulation, which is quite an interesting thing. But that's good because if they weren't, it would all be done by half-lives. And, you know, if you take half away from 400, you get 200. You take half away from 200, you get 100. And you just keep going, and it takes forever. So I should imagine that's why they have done that like that. One of the things I'm noticing is that we are pumping out hydrogen into our atmosphere suits out there. Not great, not wonderful. So I rebalanced a few of the values. This seems to be something that I have to do almost every time I load the game. There seems to be different balances of the pressures of the hydrogen and oxygen's coming out. I don't know if that's actually a thing or something I need to tweak or something like that. I know obviously the easy way of dealing with it would just be throw a gas filter on there, but I don't know, I've got this nice little system on the go. I don't feel like I need to spend the power because, you know, we are actually getting to the point where power is a consideration. We are using all three geysers worth of gas to make power, and I'm still not 100% convinced that we are producing enough. But, you know, that's the way it is. The transverse corridors are really starting to come together now, but unfortunately, one thing that I did not remember at the time, you just saw me check the priorities but didn't actually, like, check them properly, is the fact that all the tiles that I placed down for the top corridor are actually on priority 9, which means they're gonna make sure they do those over every other thing, which is not actually what I wanted. What I really wanted was to get the transport tubes down and into place as quick as possible so they're not climbing ladders to get there. Like, archaic technology, let's try and not use that if we can. All right, coming back to check on Trevado again, the end of cycle 305. He is covered in germs, which wasn't really something that I thought about, which it was a little silly of me. I definitely should have thought that, you know, he is a duplicant who produces bacteria. That bacteria is going to be a little bit of a problem for us. But that's fine. We're just going to have to deal with this experiment as it happens, and we'll see what we can do about it later on. I've got a feeling I'm going to end up like just pouring a whole bunch of chlorine in there at some point and being like, right, we'll disinfect that room and try that again. Maybe we'll, it is a separate room, so maybe that is something that we can do. I just remembered that later on I will come down and make it the same room again, but you know, whatever. It's definitely something we can deal with. 700 germs in the tank. It's now just a little bit of a waiting game for me right now. We've got 700 germs in the tank we're waiting to get rid of, and we've got a duplicant with some calories that we're waiting to drop out. The whole time Hollywood or Shadow come in just to make sure he's all right, check on the animals, have a pleasant little chit chat. It says that was one thing that made me laugh. It's like, don't chit chat to the sacrificial people, you know, like you treat them as honored guests. You don't talk to them about the weather or how they think the stocks are gonna do next week, because you know they don't have a next week. So yeah, try and be nice to them. I mean, we don't want them just like going absolute nuts and realizing what's going on before it's too late. I mean, that would be the worst thing. The one thing I do want to do, looking at this area, is definitely put a line of tiles across like the space at the top, inside the room, to bring down the number of tiles inside by one, and then like maybe expand this space on the left to be a little bit better of a holding pen, so that we've got like, I don't know, a hand washing facilities and stuff like that in there. Because you know, we're not savage monsters. So Trevado seems to have enough calories to make it overnight. So let's just have a quick look around and see how everyone else is doing. One of the first things I want to do is actually bump up the priority of all the transit tubes that are leading to the job, so we can get people in and out quicker. And then we're going to watch Captain Tubbs enjoy an espresso whilst not that far away on the other side of the rock. Trevado sleeps on the metal floor as he slowly starves to death with less than 500 calories inside his tiny body, surrounded by creatures who do nothing but excrete poisonous gases for him. Watching these strange, crazy creatures flying around eating these excretions and making other things that we then rub into mushrooms. It's all a bit weird, really, if you stop and think about it. I'm not really sure I'm comfortable with how this episode is starting to end up here. But at 300 calories, we are really starting to get there. Really just waiting for the duplicates to start filling in the rest of the tubes. And we'll know when it happens, because the steady stream of duplicants going up and down the ladders will just suddenly stop. 230 calories left. The time is getting very nigh for our name Trevado, for our man Trevado here. Main man? I don't know. Whatever. 150 calories. For the sake of tradition and the sake of the colony, this man has been printed, brought into life for a mere handful of cycles, and now his sacrifice will be made for the good of the colony. Or at least this is what I keep telling the rest of the colony, and they all seem fine with it, if I'm to be honest. And there we go. We have a dead duplicate. I have no idea whether this is actually going to spawn a morb or not, and unfortunately it's something that takes a extended period of time. So I've told everyone to like tidy up the area, and we're just going to leave that body there. Another thing that I'm going to do is start poking my way in through to space. Just above the anti-entropy cooling device up above, there is actually a layer of abyssalite, and then above that the regolith layer begins, and literally the regolith is all that separates us from space. So it's a thing to watch out for. But nighttime has settled on, people are having a bit of a pie, and the water is flowing from the cold water tank. This is good. Flowing from the hot water tank to the cold water tank. This is good because actually our main water line was starting to sag a little bit. We got to the point where duplicants could no longer pump water out, could only actually do it via the automated process, which meant like Lysloaf had stopped, and all the high level research on the computer had also stopped. Okay, so here's the area. You can see the parallax of space through the gaps in the regolith, so that's looking pretty good. We've got, finally, it took forever, but finally we've got ourselves the transport tubes being put into place. The long build the long build time has actually kind of surprised me with these transport access tubes. I didn't realise it was going to be quite so long when I put them down. I also think that for some reason, at least as far as I have seen, only people that don't love to build have built them, so it just takes a much longer. The final tubes are finally put into place, and actually, no, we're just going to stare at that final corner and be like, why didn't you dig that? Why isn't that been put into place? Why are you working on the tiles underneath the access way when you could actually be making a full and proper access way? Thankfully, ZTech comes along and digs the hole out so we can actually get some a proper working space around there. And I thought we were going to be like, oh no, the floor's not been done. How are they actually going to do any of this? But if we stop and take a moment to watch, people are still coming in and out of the access tubes fine. So, you know, that's fine, I suppose. Actually, now that I say that, they only came out of the access tubes, and I know that they can come out of a dead end. So that's a thing. One of the things we're going to have to do is put another oxygen system down. You can see that these atmosphere suits are literally just consuming all the oxygen that is being produced by this one electrolyzer, two electrolyzers. So we're going to have to keep an eye on that. And other things that we're going to keep an eye on are, of course, this saline farm. Waiting now for that outhouse to be taken down so that it can become a stable again. And just waiting to see whether Trivaldo will actually make a morb and therefore validate my life choices. But with that, I will say thank you very much for joining for this adventure, ladies and gentlemen. I will see you when we're going to do all of those things. Bye!